substitute teacher. This bottle's not a pretty sight. I owe the man some money, so I'm turning over, honey. You see, Mr. Faded Glory is once again doing time. This is the Community Solutions Podcast. Jason Bradley, Andrew Richter, giving the what for to the whoever is running the shadow government of this state. How you doing?
I'm doing terrific until you said that. Who's running the shadow government? Well, that's an open-ended question.
Yes, it is.
It definitely is. I tell you what, December is here. Snow is here.
Yes.
It was not the avalanche that we were promised by our so-called experts.
Which is good. It stayed north where it belongs.
Well, north got hit pretty good.
24 inches.
Yeah, your old territory got hit really hard.
My brother had to have a guy he knows with a front-end loader come and clear his driveway. His truck with his plow on the front of it was not sufficient to get his driveway cleared.
Holy cow. Wow, that's amazing.
That's some snow.
I'll tell you what.
That's not messing around right there. That's some real snow.
No, and we haven't had the super cold stuff. We usually don't get that till January.
Oh, it's coming.
Till I turn a year older.
It's coming in about a week, Andrew.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. I think I saw that we had some negative numbers coming next week.
Well, Jay, first off, the
temperatures are going to be almost as low as the scores across the state for math and reading. So
probably a coin flip to who's going to do better. Boy, that's pretty low.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what. Now, Treat Her Like a Lady, that was the song?
That was a line from the song. That's not the song itself.
Darn, because I know that.
Oh.
That's the Temptations.
Yeah, that's not what this is. No,
I don't even remember. I don't even remember the lyrics now, because once I heard "Treat Her Like a Lady," I kept singing the Temptations song in my head, so I missed the rest of it. So
you just started.
I'm going to give myself another quarter of credit for that. But I knew the answer. I knew the Temptations.
But that's not the song.
Yeah, but it was a line. It was a line in the song.
Oh, my word.
Yeah, remember, we're grading on a curve here. Wow. I mean, so that's now 9.5.
No, it's not.
9.5 or 10.5?
No, that's none. That's
none?
I might take away points for that. That's...
Who the hell was it? Just in like, will I know this band or this guy?
Well, maybe. This is a band that a lot of other bands came out of, actually. They were big on the Seattle scene. And
so is it grungy?
Yeah. The band was called Mother Love Bone, and Andrew Wood, the singer, died, and then out of that came Pearl Jam, and he roomed with the singer had roomed with Chris Cornell.
Another passing away too young.
Yes.
Okay, I would have never gotten Bubba the Love Sponge or whatever you said the band
name
was.
Of the song is Chloe Dancer, Crown of Thorns.
Okay, so, but I'm still going to give myself a quarter of a credit for knowing the Temptations song. So I'm at 9.5 on 142 episodes now.
Are you sure you're a conservative?
Well, yeah, but I'm grading on a curve.
Taking credit for things you didn't do? My word.
Well, it just makes me...
It's like you've been hanging out with Jerry Nadler. That's the kind of reality that you're...
Well, I got
you're...
behind him at the buffet table, so I starved. So, yeah.
Word.
Did you see the hearings where he fell asleep? He fell asleep in his... Yeah. Normally, when I listen to Jonathan Turley talk, I fall asleep, but he was actually interesting this time.
Yeah.
So, anyway, Jay, I gotta say something about national news real quick.
Okay.
What do you make of... it's kind of a sad day. No more Kamala, the Ugandan giant.
That's true.
And we get Mike Bloomberg. Now, what does that tell you? You know this stuff as well as anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And I still think that the Democratic nominee has not entered the race yet. I'm still going to go on.
You're waiting for Hillary, or
And there's maybe one or two others that I'm not going to say here. But yeah. I'm
Adam Schiff.
No, he ain't going to get in. He's too busy off on another wild goose chase. I think there could be another one or two that gets in. But Hillary is one because she doesn't have to win the primaries. The superdelegates are still the Clinton-Obama people. She can win them all again and upend anybody. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, Biden has no chance. There's no way you can finish fourth or fifth and... Iowa and New Hampshire and restart your campaign on Super Tuesday. I don't understand that strategy.
Yeah, I don't either.
You know, when the sitting vice president finishes, or the former vice president will finish polling fifth right now in Iowa, last I saw.
Wow.
Now, he can win South Carolina. He can win some of the bigger states, but I think it's a losing strategy to work backwards.
Right.
So Bloomberg is in. Now, Bloomberg getting in.
Yes.
And he brings a whole set of problems with
him. Yes, guard your sodas.
Well, guard your sodas, but, I mean, this guy was a Democrat. He was a Republican, supposedly. He was an independent. Well, when he wanted Rudy Giuliani's support to be mayor, he said one thing.
Yeah.
Then he drifted back again. He's another 80-year-old white guy with a bunch of money.
I don't think his positions have ever changed. I think he's just kind of floated around from party to party. He's a progressive.
Yeah, he's done what he's had to do to win and to gain power for himself. But let me ask you something.
Yes.
And Bloomberg's got no enthusiasm anywhere. I mean, nobody's jumping up and down that he's in the race now. I did see a Bloomberg commercial the other day.
I did, too.
And Mrs. Clinton not saying no completely.
Right.
Because she could get in April or May.
Sure.
And still win this. Because the Democrats have the most undemocratic way of appointing delegates.
Oh, absolutely.
So she doesn't have to do anything. And the fact that Bloomberg and Hillary are over this thing, what does that tell you about this field? These 39 people who've gotten in this race, okay? That guess what? The Democrats are saying it out loud. They're losing.
Uh-huh.
They're losing badly.
Mm-hmm.
So, Jay, it is December. We start voting on February 3rd.
Yes.
I'm going to put you on the spot.
All right.
You tell me, what do you think is going to... Not necessarily who wins the nomination. I mean, nobody knows because it snowballs with the calendar compressed.
Yeah.
It didn't used to be like that. What happens from here on out?
Well...
Not that I care.
I'm just curious
what you think.
I'm surprised that some of these people are still in, that we lose Kamala the Ugandan giant, but we still have some of these people hanging around at 0%.
Not for long. I mean, like you and I talked privately.
Still in.
Cory Booker's the next one out
because
the Democrats are going to put pressure on him to run in the Senate again.
Right. So he'll have to be out in order to file.
He'll have to be out by March to file, just like what happened with Marco Rubio and Rand Paul last time. They had to make a decision in early on and decided, nope, I'm not going to win this. And Booker has to do the same. And he's not winning.
Oh,
he's been running for president for 6 years, and he's still 2 points below don't know, no opinion. I mean, he's gotten nowhere. He's done everything. He's played the race card. He's done anything possible, and he's gone nowhere, literally.
Yep.
So he's out. I mean, who else is out? Who else is out right away?
Oh, I can't even remember who's in.
Is
Marianne Williamson still in?
I don't know. I mean,
the hugs and love candidate?
Probably. Who's the one that we're not looking at right now who moves up?
Andrew Yang hasn't really had his chance to shine yet. He's kind of hung just a little back, but he has enough people that are interested, I think, that he's going to get his moment in the sun soon.
So he's the one you think that
he might be the next Mayor Pete one. I don't know. I mean, do you think Mayor Pete's already, the shine's already coming off of that? Yeah.
Because now he's going to get scrutinized. Now he has to raise money. Now he's not the innocent gay guy from Indiana. He has to stand up policy-wise, delegate-wise, prove that he's tough enough. And he's auditioning to run 12 years from now is what he's doing. He's auditioning to run for governor or something. He knows he's not ready. He's putting his name out there. Everybody else in the race is twice his age. I mean, I think that's part of it, too, that the older liberals are glomming on to Biden or somebody else, and the younger ones don't want a 78-year-old white guy, and they, you know, the identity politics are always there on that side.
Yeah, and, you know, you've got a certain amount of Democrats that will never vote for a socialist. I mean, it's true. You've got a certain number, I think, who will only vote for a socialist.
Where's an independent candidate fit in this?
Well, I mean,
I don't know who that would be, but where's the Ross Perot who could come
the
in?
The Starbucks guy. Is he still running?
I don't know.
Because he was going to run third party.
I'm not sure.
Yeah. I haven't heard
Starbucks
from him in a while.
I associate with independent, but.
No, me neither. Yeah. Well, I mean, and that's the thing. I mean, he's as left as any of them, but he knows he doesn't have a shot in the Democratic Party, so he's running third party.
Okay, so it's not a Ross Jesse Ventura candidacy.
No.
It's another Green Party person or something, if you want to call it.
Yeah, I don't know what party it will be, but maybe it will be the coffee party.
So you don't see anybody emerging. You don't see any surprises. You don't see a surprise knockout.
No, I mean, from everything I hear, you know, there's been these rumblings Michelle Obama could come and clean house, but doesn't sound like she wants to.
No, I think it's intriguing that the former president has been so quiet, not endorsing his own vice president, which is head-scratching enough.
Right, and his good friend just got in the race, and he doesn't seem to be going anywhere, and Obama really hasn't said anything about him either.
Now, which one are you talking about?
What's his name? He was in part of the administration, and then... He just got in the last week or so.
Oh, really? Well, now you're going to stump me again.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then they must be high up. Then.
Right.
So another person gets in. Because
yeah. Oh, we've had a couple, two or three get in the last week. Yeah. Ever shifting landscape of the Democrat nomination process. It's. It's ugly.
I'm going to predict President Trump gets 340 electoral votes. That's what I'm looking
for. Wow, that's big.
Yeah, because I think he holds everything, and I think he flips New Hampshire, Nevada.
New Hampshire, wow.
Yeah, I mean, he lost by 0.22, I think, last time.
I suppose.
I think without Gary Johnson in New Mexico, I think that's a 50-50 state.
Yeah.
I think there's a reasonable chance... I don't know how hard he'll campaign because he doesn't need to win any of these states, but I still think that the left has done better in Colorado, but a socialist will not do well there, and I think he has a chance to win back some of the President Bush's coalition when he won there. I think he can take that state. I think Nevada is his for the taking. I think he could expand much more. I don't think he'll win here. I think he'll do well.
Yeah.
You know, I think it'll be a 1-3 point margin. But Minnesota's like Massachusetts. It just doesn't flip on a national level.
Oh, that makes me sad.
Yeah. I think the other state is Maine. I think Maine, he won the one electoral vote because they split them, like Nebraska.
Right.
But I believe the state was 48-46 or something
really
like that.
Close.
I think he flips. I mean, it wouldn't take much to flip that. So I think he flips most of those. I'm going to concede Virginia for now.
But it looks like he's going to keep Wisconsin and Pennsylvania and Ohio and Florida.
I think so. And I think Michigan may be the one I'm more worried about. But I also think the president hasn't really even begun to go there and make the case and all that. And I think once he does that, I think you're going to see things change. And look, if they're polling even, Trump's ahead by 5. Okay, that's the real truth. So let's remember, learn our lesson from 2016.
Right.
So anyhow, I'm going to go out on a limb here. And I'm still going to say other wins this nomination. And I'm going to say Trump expands everything next year.
Yeah.
And I'm going to say, I think you're going to see a shocking, I think March 3rd, provided somebody like Hillary doesn't get in late, Mm-hmm. We may know the nominee March 3rd.
Wow.
17 states will be up that date.
Right.
Including California. Now, the way they proportion delegates.
Yeah. Well, it is California.
On paper, it may not be over. But yeah. I think we could know that day. And I'm going to say that day, Joe Biden drops out. There's my bold prediction.
Wow. He just may.
I think he's, if he doesn't win South Carolina, which is the only early state he has a prayer to win,
yeah,
he's gone by March, by Super Tuesday.
Wow.
He can't, there's no way he can survive it, because if people start dropping out, they're not going to go to Biden.
Right.
Okay, they're not.
Nope.
You know, and we saw this with Hillary in 08. She had this big lead nationally, supposedly, mm-hmm, and Obama was way behind, and one by one, Edwards was gone, Bill Richardson was gone, blah, blah, everybody else. Yeah. Biden ran that year, too. Where did all those votes go? They didn't go to Mrs. Clinton.
Everybody knows who Biden is.
Yeah, so.
If they wanted him, they would be supporting him.
Yeah. So, you know, he's, you know, it's hopeless. I wish him the best, though. I hope he goes and babbles at his retirement home and everybody falls asleep around him like a judiciary.
Maybe they have a pool.
Maybe. Possibly. Pool and playing pool.
Yes.
Now, you got a little story from Rochester.
What's a little local lowdown here. Rochester residents are voicing their concern for Elton Hill's drive lane conversion. This is
I know him.
Yeah.
He sings
Tiny Dancer,
Rocket Man, yeah. Like a Candle in the Wind, or something like that.
Elton Hills, yes.
On a Saturday night.
You nailed it. KIMT3 News, KIMT.com has this article. And the city, we've talked about this so many times, where...
We've talked about this ad nauseum.
There's four lanes of traffic. Traffic is moving along just swimmingly. And then the city decides, hey, we're going to take one of those lanes away. And in fact, we're going to take two of those lanes away because the center lane is just a turning lane. I mean, except for the people that choose to use it as a passing lane and pretty near kill people. But that's what they're doing here, called a road diet. They don't mention that term here in the article, but that is what it's called.
Well, the residents do.
Yeah.
The city does not.
You're right.
By the way, K-Mint, we'll call it.
Yes.
Hard-hitting reporting.
Oh, yes.
Real investigative journalism.
Oh, absolutely.
In this.
Absolutely. But, yeah, the residents are not happy lane away. Well, you're taking two lanes away, in effect. So you have a four-lane road that becomes a two-lane road with a turn lane in the middle.
Oh, a complete street,
yes,
do we call it that?
Yes, a complete street is exactly what we would call that.
It is suitable for all users.
Not so suitable for drivers.
Yeah.
As we have seen around the cities where they have done that, most notable... we've talked about what they did on Bive and, you know.
Stopping grounds.
Yeah. They have done that plenty of places around the state, both in urban, suburban, and I guess rural areas as well, which is kind of shocking that out in the rural areas you would need
active living, baby.
Active living, that's right. Need to have room for those.
There's a snowmobile lane.
Two and bikers that take it.
Dorky helmets.
Yeah. So, residents are calling this conversion a road diet, but that isn't just what residents are calling it. That is actually the term that planners use.
It is in the Community Solutions Glossary of Terms.
It is. For those that have taken our training, they've seen that in there.
Well, the city wants this change for more safety, better speed control, and, of course, more pedestrian and bicycle-friendly.
Of course.
Everybody's coming to the city council meetings demanding bike lanes again.
No, they're not.
You know, they're all coming with pitchforks.
No, they're not.
Oh, they're not?
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
Yeah, you know why? Because they're going to have the BST.
Yes.
That's going to stop it all. The bicycle sales tax.
Well, and the people of the community started an organization called Take Back Our Streets.
Love it.
That's how we got our start around a street that they wanted to make four lanes into six lanes. And so they have this group, and they've had a couple of meetings already, and they said, in fact, they had well over 125 people, including four council members and the mayor, at one of their meetings, which... You know, when we started, actually, this was before you. This is just like my, the first thing I ever did. I held a town meeting in the bottom of the VFW there, and I told people what was going on with the road project. And not only, you know, did I have my neighbors, some council people, and some of their agitators found their way into that meeting as well. Wanted to get their two cents in and have their side of the story heard, even though I had all the facts. You know, it wasn't anything that they could argue with in there.
Was Jerry Nadler in charge of the? Yeah,
close, close. We had Mr. Anderson on the council. So,
One thing about him, I'll always have the better body.
My goodness! Wow. Yeah. So this is just another example of a city deciding to do something just because, you know, it fits their comprehensive plan. That
well, here's something that concerns me as the last paragraph of this.
Yes.
On December 9th, city staff is having a community input meeting at Hoover. What's Hoover?
Hoover? I don't know.
Is that a school? The president?
Must be. It's
vacuum cleaner?
Not the Hoover Dam.
Okay.
That'd be a long commute.
Yeah. Everyone is encouraged to attend. The city engineer will then take the information and come up with a proposal to present to the council on December 16th. If the proposal isn't accepted, it will not be reconsidered until next November. So the council will then take a year to come up with their sales pitch.
Yes.
As to why this, they'll use words that have been think tanks and focus groups mm-hmm. have used. They will have the time to mount a campaign against the people who don't yep. like this, so on and so forth. They'll probably could do it. They could mm-hmm. do it after the election in the lame duck time.
That often happens.
Also possible. So look out for this. If you're down there in the most boring city in the face of the earth, Rochester, Minnesota, okay. where nothing's open past 9:30. Now, I'm kind of half kidding.
Yeah.
When I worked for Best Buy, yeah. I went down to Rochester all the time. And believe me, you had to get all your drinking in before 9:30.
I haven't been down there too many times. I played a New Year's Eve thing at their Civic Center once, and maybe I've been through there again.
I had to go to a Republican convention there. That was pretty boring.
Oh, yeah. That was I don't remember that. So
you weren't there. It was 2014. Well. So anyhow.
There we go.
So look out for that. Look for this to get tabled.
Yes.
And a marketing campaign to begin.
Yes. That's probably what will happen.
Figuring these people will just, we'll just let it go for mm-hmm. now. And we'll come back at it again when you people are busy watching, you know, whatever, season 4 of The Ranch or something.
Right. And there's a reason why they say next November it could pop up, because it is after the election and they'll be able to do whatever they want.
Don't want to give people an issue.
Do it early enough in the next session, you know, after the election, and nobody will remember it the next time the election comes around. Because we saw that too. It took us to make things an issue for people to kind of go, hey, yeah, what? I do remember that, and I'm not very happy about it. Otherwise, people kind of go back to sleep, and we've seen that over and over and over again. So.
Yes, lots of sleeping going on. Now, Jay,
yes.
you move on to what we're going to kind of get into here.
Okay.
How do we bridge that? How do we bridge that to our next topic?
Well, oftentimes when things like road diets are done, I mean, they take money to do. You know, you're redoing an entire road, and so sometimes to get that done, you might have to write a bond.
It's that simple. Just write a bond, and
investors will go ahead and purchase that bond, and then you have the distinct pleasure of paying them off over a 20-year period, more than, you know, with interest, more than the project would have cost.
Yes. Now, we've talked about, you might be saying, we talked about bonds on episode whatever it was a long time ago.
Yeah.
I want to get more specific on bonds. We're going to use a few cities here, as well as a park district, as examples. But first, Jay, let's back up.
Yes.
How many people in our little peanut gallery here listening, we have a very smart audience, but how many people do you think could explain to you in any capacity how a municipal bond works or what it is or what it does or what could read it on a report and tell you anything about it? It's your money.
You sure okay. We can? No, I'm just kidding.
There are days I think I can't.
Yeah. Well, and this is the thing. We throw the term bond around, and there are different types of bonds. And this show isn't going to be just about, you know, an education session on bonds. We're going to talk about total city debt, laser focus in on some cities and what their debt is, and teach you kind of how to look for your city's debt level and debt capacity. So go anywhere.
They're not easy to find.
Oh, no.
Not easy to find.
Oh, no, as they say up in yeah. Bemidji. Oh, no.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So you got a lot of debt there, eh?
Now, yeah.
Here's the thing. Think of it like this. This is how I would describe it. You want to buy something.
Yep.
And you don't have the money.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's what a city, that's what a municipality, because school districts can do this.
Yes.
Counties could do this. Park districts can do this. Cities can do this. Townships can do this.
Yes.
They all have the ability to spend money that they don't have. Don't give me this balanced budget crap.
No.
Okay. The state of Minnesota supposedly balances their budget, and they do so with money that they have yet to collect or spend.
Yes, and their balanced budget deals with taxes that come in and things of that nature, but they don't deal with other types of revenue.
I'll take it a step further. Yes. Their bonding, they consider a revenue.
Right.
Because they're selling the bond, so therefore that's money.
Right.
Despite the fact the interest will add to the expenses.
Yes. So just, let me break it down just really simply for you guys. I used to have a Series 7, so hopefully I can explain this. I used to deal in securities work a little bit. A little bit. It was a long time. But a bond is a debt instrument. So basically, you don't have money. You want some money. Some money would be nice. To do, you know, to buy a capital asset or whatever, you need a new bulldozer, you need some police cars, you need a new chair or toilet in the men's room or whatever. And you decide that, okay, we don't have the money for it. So what we're going to do is write a bond. A municipal bond is different than a savings bond or a corporate bond. It deals specifically with city issues. You have general obligation bonds, and you have revenue bonds, and there are different types of bonds.
We should mention that there are some things that you have to use general obligation bonds on.
Yes.
It's backed by the full faith and credit of the government. Translation, we can take it from you if we want to.
Right.
So something, and then a revenue bond, which is very common as well, used a little less, is for something that generates revenue. For example, yes. If you wanted to build, I use this example, a toll road for like out in Illinois.
Yes.
They are financed by lease revenue bonds because the tolls, that's how the Erie Canal was built.
Mm-hmm.
DeWitt Clinton, the governor of New York.
Yes.
He sold the bonds to, he actually kind of started a trend, not a great one.
Right.
Although the Erie Canal was a good idea. How they paid for it was set a precedent for doing other projects.
Right.
Even building, say, a public works building, because you can argue that utilities create revenue, because that's how the city views your water bill. So I just want to mention that there, if you're going to build a city hall, if you're going to build a fire station, general obligation bonds, if you're going to build something that gets revenue, you can use either. But usually they use a lease revenue bond. Some cities, Crystal being one, I have it written in their charter that a lease revenue bond is harder to pay, has to be passed by a supermajority. That's not the case in a statutory city.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, Look up your city, see what you are, that kind of thing. Just for a little background.
Right. Exactly. So the person that wants the money writes the bond and then puts it out to the market and looks for a suitor, if you will. Somebody comes along that says, hey, I would like to invest in a bond, because generally they are a safer instrument than, you know, being in stocks. And, it just, you know, you, on the range of things, like international stocks are the most risky. And then you have, you know, growth stocks, and you have blue chip stocks, and you have mixed, you know, investments where you have mutual funds and bonds and stocks and things, and options are really risky. But then over on the other end, you have all these bonds, and they're generally used for people that are in retirement or close to retirement, or they're also used with other investors, you know, because you don't ever want everything all in risky things. It's just, what mix do you want? And you have less of the bond investments and bond mutual funds and things like that when you are younger, and they tend to be a greater percentage of your investment basket when you're older. And so the investor goes out and they purchase these bonds. And then what happens is, over time, the person, the entity that writes the bond, has to pay the purchaser of the bond back with interest. And that interest rate, you know, is, that's over and above the principal amount. The principal amount is what the bond is written for. Say that it is a $10,000 bond, you know, and then it could have another, in this day and age, maybe a 4.5% interest rate or something like that on top of it that would have to be paid back. And there's a bond schedule, and a bond then matures at a certain date. That's when it's fully paid back to the person who bought the bond.
Yes, the bond matures, as yes. they call it. Yes.
And you can do it early, but there's usually ramifications to that.
It affects your score, actually goes down if you pay them off quicker.
Right.
So in other words, and remember that the interest, just like a loan, is front loaded.
Right.
So if you have, I'll just use what cities, they talk in millions.
Yeah.
I'll talk it from a city perspective, not an investor. They do a $10 million project, pay back $13 million,
mm-hmm.
The interest is very front. Say it's a 10-year bond.
Yeah.
Most of the interest will be paid in the first 3, 4, 5 years. Mm-hmm. That's one of the reasons, too, why it's hard to pay bonds off early, because you've already paid most of the interest on it. You're
right.
Paying back principal. So there's no incentive to pay it back quicker.
Mm-hmm.
Again, the bankers are smart. You're yeah. borrowing for a reason, because you
right.
don't got no money.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so they get how to get you. They do the same way on your house
uh-huh.
they do to a municipality that you're funding.
Yes.
So, now, you may be... Jay, here's what gets me.
Mm-hmm.
I'll watch a city frantically,
mm-hmm.
frantically debate over every pencil, every piece of toilet paper, every paper towel, you know, every pair of used underwear.
Yes.
In their $10 million budget.
That's true.
Yet if you look up their comprehensive annual financial report and see how much they owe, it's like, what is the point
mm-hmm.
of that debate that you just had for 6 months about how many pencils the secretary has at their desk?
Right.
I mean, and I think people would be shocked. You know, you sit here and also how little interest there is
mm-hmm.
in reporting this or even attempting to understand it. Because, you know, when you and I, back in the day,
mm-hmm.
okay, first got out a comprehensive annual financial report and had no idea what the hell it was.
Yes.
The first thing that floored me was how much money Crystal citizens owed their government
mm-hmm.
over the next 20, 25 years, which we're still paying on.
Yes.
You know, a lot of it we still are. Some of it was just been created since with special assessments and so on. So, and it was far and away more than their little $9-8 million, but whatever it was at the time.
Yeah.
And I remember looking at, what is this? The hell is this crap?
A lot of money, yeah.
You know, the community center was 15 years old, yet they still owed money on it. You know, the pool, which was voted in, mm-hmm. but they just got done paying that, I want to say, in like 2017.
Yeah.
Okay, so, and the special assessments, they'll be paying on that till the last, till about 2037.
Mm-hmm.
So you sit there and you go, wait a minute. You're getting a bill at your property, the city portion, for $500 or $600 or whatever it is. It's just the city portion now. But when you look at the total bill of what you owe,
mm-hmm.
how do you ever shrink the size? I mean, how does that ever get reconciled? It's almost like a number that can't be calculated.
Right.
So it is eye-opening to see these amounts and what these people and what they can borrow.
Oh, yeah.
Let's not forget, you know, the state statute 476 sets a limit, but that limit is high. I mean, they can pretty much bond anytime they want to.
Yeah. Yeah, they pretty much can. You know, another thing that they can do is split it up. So you have what's called overlapping debt, where you have multiple.
It's kind of like going to the prom. We all go to the debt prom together. You know,
well, and that's the thing. I mean, overlapping debt is where, say, a city takes out some bonds, but they also do it in conjunction with a county or a school district or something like that. But keep in mind, you know, you may only be paying X amount on your city bonds, but you're also paying the county for the county bonds. You're also paying the school district for the school district bonds. You're not getting out of, you know, the total.
Oh, it's not
limit.
Free. The city calls that free money, though. Right? That's not free money?
No. Free money.
Now, look.
Yeah.
We're gonna give just a couple of examples here, and we're not going to read it. Look, you can follow along. You can keep score at home.
Yeah.
You know, like Herb Carneal used to say. And we could pick on a city like New Hope, but that's too easy.
Yes.
I mean,
those numbers would be really big, and we might not be able to grasp.
New Hope is the next Detroit. Let's just call it what it is. It's D-Toilet.
Yes.
Okay, so, I mean, New Hope, you're hopeless. That debt's going to be with you until you're 231 years old. Now,
yes.
I want to pick on Maple Grove, Minnesota. First. Now, that's a city we haven't mentioned much.
Not really.
They're actually one of the largest cities in Minnesota now.
Yes, they are.
I mean, it was a cow pasture 30 years ago, and now it's
mm-hmm.
you know,
it's got lots of strip malls.
It's got lots of stuff.
Yeah.
Now, of course, if you look up their comprehensive annual financial report at maplegrovemn.gov, yeah, you know me. If you look it up, of course, the bonds are not on page one.
Oh, no.
They're not on page five, not on page 15. They actually are further up than the next ones we'll talk about.
Yeah.
Page 46.
46.
Jay, shall we move to page 46?
Yeah, we can do that.
They have a bonding schedule. And their bonding schedule includes their principal, their BAB credit. What the hell is that? Doesn't
BAB,
matter.
Yeah, I don't know.
I could think of a few things, but I won't. And they have their general obligation bonds, the principals that they owed. Notice how they're going down. Okay. The interest is also going down because that's front loaded. Then you look at, they go all the way to 2034.
Mm-hmm.
Maple Grove citizens, you owe over $52.5 million. Oh, no, that's not it. You got to add the interest.
Oh, yeah.
Almost $9.5 million. So, Maple Grove, you owe $63 million to municipal bond investors.
Wow.
$63 million.
That's a lot of money.
Now, that is way more money than their annual budget or what they're paying, you know, Barney Fife to, you know, write up jaywalking tickets or something like that. Their budget is a sparrow belch into this total that they owe in general obligation bonds. But Jay, we're not done.
Of course not.
Go to the next page. page 47. We have special assessment bonds. They go through the year 2027. And what do we find? Another $24 million in special assessment bonds.
Yeah.
Add the interest. Oh, only another $3.5 million.
Yeah.
So you're looking at about $28 or
$29
billion you're looking at on top of the $63
million. Wow. That's up near $90 million.
Yeah, it's like Rocky Balboa said. Mm-hmm. Oh, these numbers almost add up to nine. Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. You're how do you get any handle on that? If I'm elected to the city council in Maple Grove,
yeah,
how do I get any handle on? And I could come in there and say, okay, no more new debt.
Mm-hmm.
Fine, but it's kind of like saying, like kind of like owing $10,000 on your credit card and saying, okay, I'm not going out to dinner and using my credit card tonight.
Right.
Where do I start to pay all this back?
Well, you got to start spending less.
Right. But if I spend less and I'm still servicing the debt,
right,
I've got to cut a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
I got to cut 10-15% out of the budget just to break even with the debt service.
Well, here's what conservatives don't understand. And you have these conservatives that, I'm going to cut taxes, I'm going to cut taxes, I'm going to cut taxes, and they never do. You know why they can't? Because they are servicing so much debt. It makes it impossible. I mean, you take that and then you take like costs of employees and all that kind of stuff, and it's really hard to cut that. So you are stuck with something that you're not able to cut. And they don't know that going in. You got to have total financial health. And part of financial health is being debt-free. Part of that is having savings. And part of that, you know, is just spending less than you make. There's so many people that spend more than they make, you know, and they rack up these credit cards. That's basically what the city is doing. I mean, you could look at it this way.
Or look at it this way. They're getting a degree in sociology,
mm-hmm,
or African-American studies, spend $100,000 in debt to do it. Now they're working as waiters.
Right. Well, and you could think of it this way almost, that let's say as a credit card holder, you know, you're writing a bond every time that you use your credit card, and the credit card company is the one who buys your debt. Yeah. And you have to pay them back with interest, except there's not really a maturity date on a credit card. That's the only difference.
Yeah.
And it's not really back or front-loaded, front-loaded interest. You keep paying throughout.
It's complex
versus simple interest.
Differently, but it's the same principle.
It's the same concept. Yeah. And so when you're looking...
Just remember, I said it first.
Yeah. When you're looking at a city, you know, and you come in saying, I'm going to cut taxes, I'm going to cut taxes, you have to look as someone who is responsible at the complete financial health of that city. So you have to look at the total debt and how you're going to pay that off. You have to look at, you know, how much do you have saved for these projects so that you don't have to go into debt for the next one.
You need a long-term capital plan.
Mm-hmm.
You need, okay, at what point are we going to have to replace these buildings? At what point, you know,
yeah,
people might want to build a pool or a community center or whatever. Fine, if they're willing to pay for it, but... Are you going to bond for that, or are you going to have the money for it?
Right.
You also have to have a total picture of the revenue side of the budget. Now, we've talked about this a million times, whether that's through property taxes, franchise fees, licenses and permits, you know, there's local government aid. There's all sorts of things that all make up that pie.
Mm-hmm.
And the property tax is one of them.
Yes.
But... what I would like to see, what you would like to see, is that simplified,
yeah,
to where they're not saying, okay, we cut your property taxes, but we're slapping on a franchise fee.
Right.
You know, and then that franchise fee is servicing the debt for that road that we special assessed you.
No, as a taxpayer, you should want all of your taxes to be on the general budget, because then you're able to see it on your tax statement. versus having all of these hidden taxes where you don't get to see what you're paying.
Right. Most you're paying people think, this and that's all.
Most people think, oh, I'm only paying $129 a year for my taxes. You're not. No, wait, that's usually, you know, 40, 50, 60% of what you pay, but there's all this other stuff that's collected in a different manner.
If you think that, you wait till the mail comes and that special assessment comes for $5,000 plus interest.
Yeah.
And tell me that's all you're paying.
Right.
You want to get people at a council meeting with pitchforks. Give them a special assessment. That'll get everybody crazy.
Yes.
You know, in some ways, I hate to say this, but in some ways, in our old stomping grounds, that was a wake-up call for people.
Yeah, it was.
Anybody paying off that special assessment, they understand that the levy isn't it.
Right.
So, in some ways, it bolstered the case that you and I make.
Yeah.
That special assessments are just a hidden tax somewhere else, and they aren't part of the operating budget that they spend 6 months talking about.
But special assessments do that, but a pool bond doesn't. People don't get that, you know. School referendum, it's for the kids. People don't get that, you know. Well, it's
and again, school referendums, remember, schools have two budgets,
an operating budget and
a deferred maintenance budget. Those two budgets don't talk to each other.
Right.
When you talk about an operating levy, that's why they do an operating levy and a bonding levy. Mm-hmm. They're two separate things.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So.
Absolutely.
Our audience understands that most of the time. Right?
Yes.
So.
Yes. So, I mean, I guess we'll move on to the next city, but it is important to look at the entire health of the city finances, not just come in willy-nilly and start saying you're going to cut taxes, because you'll find out real soon you're not going to be able to.
Well,
in most cases, I think.
Well, and again, it takes an educating process of yourself and residents. It takes repetition. It takes long-term vision, which sometimes is hard to sell. But ultimately, if you're gonna say, okay, we're gonna save $6 million by increasing one tax $100 to save $5 million over a length of time, people will put that together and get that. So it does take. And again, we live in a debt culture. Think about how much money you spend in a month personally servicing debt, whether that's your mortgage payment, your car payment, your credit card bill, your student loan, you name it, okay, any kind of thing, a personal loan, payday loan, whatever, you are servicing debt. You spent money you didn't have, okay, and are paying it back.
Mm-hmm.
So when you put it in that perspective, we put a vacation on the credit card. How many people do that?
Right.
Be honest here out here, folks. How many people, you know, my wife and I are going to Florida again in March, and we're buying our tickets this month. And it's like, I'm not putting it on the credit card. My wife sure as hell isn't either.
Yeah.
And we saved it up, and we're going to pay for it all now.
That's
you know, I'm not going to be paying for this vacation in 2023, you know.
Yeah.
So then how much did that vacation really cost me? You know, so think of it that way. So let's move on, Jay.
Yes.
We have not talked. We have been on the air for almost 3 years.
Yes.
And the Three Rivers Park District really has not come up much.
Not a whole lot.
I mean, we've referenced it in passing, but they are a municipality.
Yeah.
And they have bonding authorities. You'll be glad to know that you owe them also. And so
absolutely.
Do I.
Absolutely.
You and I both owe them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe we can pay them back together. Okay?
I believe we are.
Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, page 24. Now, I'm gonna say something here that I do not see on here.
Mm-hmm.
This is important. I do not see their bond schedule for the future. I see what they paid in the past, but I cannot find their future bond schedule. And that is naughty, naughty. I hope they didn't get an award for excellent reporting here, like everybody seems to get. They all get this the head of the class thing or something for excellence in reporting. But I can't find. I can find what they owe, which between government and business type activities, which again is a little bit different. It'd be like a golf course maybe or something like that.
Right.
They owe $68 million, Jay.
Wow.
The Park District.
Mm-hmm.
Three Rivers Park District. I mean, honestly, now, because you and I are political, we know about this, but how many people know? How many people can name someone on the Park District? Be quiet, Jay. We know you and I can.
Yeah.
How many people can tell you what it does? What, you know, you've probably, you know, if you've been to Elm Creek or you've mm-hmm. been somewhere, that's a Three Rivers Park District place. And they have the power to tax, the power to borrow. Two of their members are appointed
by Hennepin County.
Keep that in mind.
Yep.
I mean, you're looking at $68 million, and that is nothing compared to what they can spend.
Right.
By the way, also. So, I mean, they owe a tremendous amount of money. Believe it or not, it's actually less than they've been owing in the past.
Yeah. I mean, they kind of had a change in leadership over there. Oh, what, about 2012 or so?
12 and 14.
Yeah. And yeah. Since then, the amount that they owe has dropped drastically. They've been working at paying this off, it looks like. But still, $68 million
is a lot. And not writing new bonds, which is important also. But it's kind of strange. They have this chart in there, and I'm skipping ahead to page 110, 111, of what they have paid in the past. But I do not see a chart of what they are supposed to pay in the future. And by the way, their tax capacity is about $500 million
Wow.
That they can write bonds.
Right. And we should explain that quick.
Yeah.
That there are debt limits set by the legislature as 3% of the market value of the bonds that are written.
Which is constantly in flux.
Right.
It goes down. It goes up. That's why the incentive is to assess your property high.
Right.
Yeah. So... $68 million.
Wow. Yeah, that's a lot, Andrew. I don't have that kind of change laying around.
You don't?
No.
I thought I saw it last time I was in your place.
You found it in between the cushions.
Yeah, well, I was going to pick it up, but I figured you needed it for something. So.
Well, you know me. I just kind of throw money around. I'm like Daddy Warbucks over there.
Oh, that's what you are? Okay.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what. You know, Grand Rapids is a town very near and dear to my heart.
Mm-hmm.
Great fishing, great people.
Not so great government.
Not so great government.
No.
Don't care for them too much. Go to their comprehensive annual financial report. Guess where their bond writing starts?
It's got to be a very small window because there's only 204 pages in their comprehensive annual financial report.
Okay, so out of that, you take a guess as to where this starts. Don't say 203.
Why is that the answer?
It's close.
200?
191. Once again, I don't see the future.
Yeah.
Wait, I do. I'm sorry.
Okay.
There is. Yes, this does have them. You go to 191. Now, they have got so many bonds they have written. Tax increment bonds, capital improvement bonds, street reconstruction bonds, equipment certification series, another capital improvement plan bond, another street reconstruction bond, improvement bonds, which is probably a special assessment for a street, I'm guessing.
Mm-hmm.
But go from 191, 192, 193. And you're going to see, what is the grand total here?
Oh,
okay, hold on.
Yeah.
First, let me just talk about going all the way back to 2001.
Mm-hmm.
They had an improvement bond. It finally matured in 2017. Okay. There was $35,000 is what was left. Only $875 was interest. So you can see all of the interest had been paid for the previous 16 years.
Right.
Okay. 2006, they had improvement bond. $950,000. that they still owe through the year 2022. In addition to that, another $111,000 in interest.
Wow.
2007. They still owe $930,000 on this one. Hmm. This one goes till 2023. They must have financed this longer.
Yeah.
Because they owe $138,000 in interest. Because remember, you pay more interest the longer, just like a loan, the longer you take it out, the more interest and the higher the rate usually.
Right.
Even if you got your special Moody's, you know, sextuplet A rating.
Right.
Okay. You still are, it's still not free.
No, okay. No. All the rating does, guys, is that tells you how likely the city is to pay you back.
Yeah.
As an investor, that's all that does.
As an investor, though, not as a taxpayer.
Right. As an investor, you don't get paid back as a taxpayer.
How about these 2012? Boy, I wonder what they did in 2012, Jay. They wrote two different bonds.
Mm.
One for over $1.8 million. One for over $3.1 million.
Wow.
Over $700,000 in interest payments, and these are not going to be paid off till about 2027.
Wow.
So you're looking at, here's the total.
Mm-hmm.
$21 million, including the interest, about $3 million of it is interest.
Wow.
Now that's in Little Grand Rapids of about 10,000 people.
Right.
So those 10,000 people owe $21.4 million to investors that their government has written bonds for.
That's crazy.
Now, that's it. It's nice how they lay that out. It's bad at what it is.
Right.
You know, and there's other cities where, you can't even find a table to pay it back. You don't even know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, I mean, we looked at Albert Lee. We looked at, who the hell else do we look at? Doesn't matter. But, you know, I mean, these bonds are being written constantly, and it's taking, a long, long time to pay them off. And like we said, how do you get in somewhere and make changes when you owe so much money? It's like if I were going to take over somebody else's business, okay, and you assume their debt, which is what it's called, assuming their debt.
Yes.
Okay. It could take you forever to turn that business around to pay off that debt.
It could.
Now, solutions, Jay.
Yes.
We've complained, okay? We complained a lot here. But we are Community Solutions, and we mentioned a few things already. So what is, here's my first piece of advice is you got to know what you're dealing with.
Yes.
You got to look at these things. You got to ask questions. You got to make sure you understand. Don't let their finance person give you some BS. This is normal. This is what we did last time.
Right.
Every city does it. You're going to hear a lot of that, this get-along gang stuff.
Yeah, well, that's what they're taught to do. I mean, the League of Minnesota Cities teaches you how to write debt, encourages you to write debt in order to pay for some of this stuff. So,
And another thing is you want amenities, you want things like that, you got to save up.
Yeah.
Baby. I mean, you're spending somebody else's money here.
Mm-hmm.
You're spending a future generation's money,
right?
With this, and you can't sit there and just borrow and borrow and borrow and borrow and borrow.
Yeah,
it's crazy. Now, what do you want to bet? Now, we can go into any city and do the same and find millions, far more than what their truth and taxation hearings.
Yes,
which don't even cover any part of what a small fraction of what government is spending is in those lie and taxation hearings.
Yeah, all that does is cover the budget. It does not cover any of the other stuff you'll find in the comprehensive annual financial report. And so it's not very truthful because you don't have that full picture. But it's important for us to be able to get a handle on what's being spent, not only from the budget, and the general ledger of a city, but also taking a look at what they're spending as far as bonding, and any kind of special assessments, any TIF financing, any tax abatements that are being given out, the franchise fees that are being collected. I mean, there are so many different ways that we get raked over the coals. And, you know, maybe someday we need to do a blog post where we list them out and see how many we can list.
That blog post would be from here to Timbuktu.
But the only way to combat this is to begin to sock money away. I mean, you have to pay off your debts. I mean, debt is a killer. You know, and what happens, I mean, I know we say it's the government, nothing's ever going to happen. Well, your cities do not have the ability to print money. Neither do your counties, neither do your school districts. They don't get to just go to the printing presses and run off new dollar bills. So because of that, you know, there's a downturn in the economy. People move away because maybe a company moves out of town or whatever. It could leave you in a bad position as a government.
Can I throw something out at us about Robbinsdale schools?
Yeah.
If I'm understanding this right, according to their comprehensive annual financial report, $84.4 million is what they owe in facilities maintenance bonds, capital facilities bonds, alternative facilities bonds, certificates of participation payable, I don't know what that is, capital leases, the $84.4 million.
Wow.
The district plans to use part of their new debt to pay off their current debt.
What?
Yeah.
So they're going to take out new debt to pay off the old debt.
They're going to get a new credit card.
Stupid.
To pay off the old one.
So it's a balance transfer.
Yeah.
That's all it is. Hey, with this balance transfer, you get 2.3 APR. Stupid.
Yeah, so $84.4 million. Not going to the children, right?
No.
Do it for the children.
Do it for the children, Robbinsdale. All right. All those, you know, class sizes that are getting reduced. Of course, the only class sizes that get reduced are the ones where the kids drop out of school.
Yeah.
They don't say that.
Yeah. Hey, you know what?
Yeah.
I'm in the minority here, but to me, kids who drop out do a favor to the other kids because kids are there and they're disruptive.
Yeah.
And they affect other kids' learning. If they want to go work at the car wash for a while, go figure out life, I say let them do it.
Yeah.
And that's a harsh thing that I think a lot of people don't like when I say, but I think when you force kids to be at a place, they're the ones who are that 10% or whatever are the ones affecting everybody else's learning. So if they want to go and you know, play Call of Duty all day and their parents are that negligent, I'm all right with that.
Yeah.
So.
Well, you know, there's nothing you can do to motivate people. I mean, you can try, but in the end, it's up to them.
Most teenagers aren't self-starters, but believe me, I had a mom and dad that said, you're going to be a self-starter or else. Let's just put it that way. We might starve you or lock you in a room or something. I'm being facetious here, but, you know, the point is that, you know, there is a percent that the schools are better off if they're not there.
Yeah.
And I don't share this belief that everybody's equal or everybody has to have equal outcome. Education is something you earn.
Yes.
And I don't want to go off on that tangent.
No, you can go back 2 shows ago, I think, or 3 shows ago.
Or 4 shows or 10 shows or 20 shows. We've done a lot of education shows this year.
We have.
They're good, though.
Yeah.
They're good. You go back to March and do our District 281 show.
That was good.
That was a good, really good show. Yeah. I sounded great on that show.
Really? You remember that, huh?
I did. You couldn't have been gooder until the next show we did.
Yeah. So, yeah, there are so many different ways that we can get hit. And now that we see that this bonding, I mean, it happens at the school district level, it happens at the city level, it happens at the county level, and none of it is on the tax bill that you're getting at the beginning of the year. So you really need to take a look at that, because that is the thing that you wonder why you're paying all this money and you can't account for all of it, because it's all hidden. So you got to ask yourself at some point, when have I had enough? All this stuff that the city, that the county, that the school district wants to do.
And there's nothing better than the state of Minnesota that puts a writing a bond on the revenue side of the budget.
Yes.
We're going to get money, so it's revenue.
Goodness.
We just balanced the budget
yeah.
by writing $1 billion in bonds. Gotta love them. Just
oh, my word.
I'd like to hear Peggy Flanagan try to explain that.
Yeah. My goodness.
Anyhow, I interrupted you, Jake.
No, that's fine.
I do it all the time.
That's okay. Debt, we think nothing of it, but it's important that we get a handle on it. And the culture right now at the local level is to write debt, to bond. You've heard us say it in many stories, whether it is the public works building in Crystal or it's other things around the state where they have wanted to just bond. And it took some people come along in that city of Crystal to say, no, we're going to pay cash for this. We've got the money. We're going to do it. And they have done it. And they've done it again with their park system. And they're doing it again with saving up for changes with a new police station down the line and whatever.
Bond. James Bond.
No, they're not bonding.
I had to say that.
They're not bonding. And you know, there are other cities out there that are looking to copy that.
No, no, blueprint. Sean Connery said it. Bond. James Bond.
That's about how it sounded.
Oh, is it okay?
Yeah, that's pretty good.
I interrupted you again. Now let me just say one thing here. One of the challenges you're going to have to do if you want to run for office, and one of the ways we can help you, okay, big time, is understanding financial documents.
Yes.
It's critical that you understand. Most council members, trust me when I say this, cannot explain the budget to you, wouldn't know the comprehensive annual financial report if it bit them on both ass cheeks. They cannot explain it to you. Yet they vote for it.
Mm-hmm.
Year after year after year after year. Do not be one of them. Okay? Do not be one of them.
Well, it takes time to understand it, you know. But, I mean, this is one of the major things that you get elected to do is to take care of the city finances. And if you're just writing debt, you're not being a good steward of the city finances and of the people's money because you're just carelessly spending. And when there is a downturn in the economy, and there will be, you mark my words, it might not happen in the next 4 years, but there will be. And it might happen within the next 4 years. But there will be.
Paul, we're heading in the same unsustainable trend. Property can't keep going up at the rate that it's going, and debt can't get taken. Tuition can't go up at the rate it's going. I mean,
and what's going to happen? You know, downturn in the economy. People start losing jobs. People can't pay taxes. They move out of their homes. You have vacant lots sitting there in the city. Where are you going to get your revenue from then, huh?
I guess.
Write more bonds to cover your debt. It's a vicious cycle. You can't do that. That's no way to run a city.
Or your personal life.
So you got to get your house in order, whether that's personally or as a city. You got to take care of the debt. You got to pay it down. You got to start saving. You shouldn't be buying new expensive things. You should be saving up to buy those new expensive things, whether that's a road grader, whether that is painting the water tower in town.
Where's your capital fund balance? I mean, where's your CIP fund? That's what that's for. So you don't have to borrow for that.
So we're looking for some good people that are willing to...
Or some not so good people.
Well, I think I prefer the good ones.
Oh, okay.
That are willing to hold
I'll
the
take
line.
Anyone.
Really?
No.
Really?
I'd be just saying the opposite of you to annoy you.
It's not working.
Oh, yeah. Damn. All right, I'll try harder.
Listen, here's where the rubber meets the road. You're in a city that has debt. I can almost guarantee it. I think there's probably not a city in Minnesota that doesn't have some level of debt. And what you need to do is think about how that can get paid off. It might take you stepping up and doing something about it. You know why? Because the people that are in office right now aren't doing it, or they would have. They would have started saving. They would have stopped writing bonds. You know, and maybe they tout, hey, debt's going down. We're paying down the bonds. Really? Yeah, until you take out a new bond on something else. How many times have we seen that? Where, oh, yeah, we're paying down the debt. And then we really are just, you know, biding our time because we have this other project we want to bond for. It doesn't work like that. No, you have to put principles into your daily actions that are going to keep you from spending money you don't have. So we're looking for some people with some intestinal fortitude to be able to not spend money just because something looks good, but to put a plan in place to save, to put a plan in place to reduce debt, because that is going to make the state stronger as a whole. When you don't have cities that are defaulting, and believe me, there are cities that have been defaulting out in California and the like, in Detroit, that they can't pay their bonds back. We don't want to be one of those when the economy goes south. So we need to shore up right now and make our economy strong. So where are you? Those of you who have the knowledge and the ability to be able to hold the line, not just on taxes, but on debt. That's the complete picture. That's great if you want to lower taxes. What are you going to do about debt? Because there's too many Republicans out there now that are willing to pass a new debt ceiling and pass a new debt ceiling and pass a new debt ceiling. Hey, how about we stop spending? You know, and the only way we're going to stop that is by getting rid of those people and putting in people that are willing to hold the line on that stuff.
Or making me dictator.
Well, yeah, I guess it would end then.
A lot of things would end then.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. You'd see a whole lot of 1979 Dodge Charger or 1969 Dodge Chargers out on the road.
Absolutely, you would.
You'd see a mass production start up on those again. But but you know what? This is up to you guys. And you want a strong city. You want a strong state. You want our state to kick Wisconsin's butt in something. How about we stop writing bonds? You know, how about we stop spending money we don't have?
Since we can't beat the Badgers or the Packers,
yeah,
let's cut our debt better than they can.
How about that? How about that be your Super Bowl? Go out there and cut some debt. You know? It sounds stupid, but you know what? You guys can do this. But it's going to take you standing up and doing something. So, you know, maybe in the below the show notes here and down in the comment section, why don't some of you who listen to this go in and you go into your comprehensive annual financial reports and tell us how much debt your city has? We'd like to know that, and I think the people who listen to this podcast would like to know how much debt your city has and to compare it to their city's debt, because then we're going to start to see that there's an epidemic, that it's not one city, it's not two cities, it's all the cities.
Makes you wonder, with every city, township, county, park district, what the total is for the entire state.
Oh, my goodness.
You know what?
That is a project I don't even have time for.
I wouldn't want to know. I'd commit suicide mm-hmm. halfway through it. So it's just
853 cities, 1,100. You know,
whatever amount of money it is, it would not cover my
counties.
It would not cover my antacid looking through it all.
Okay? No,
no, it wouldn't cover your Xanax, and it wouldn't cover my antacid. Okay?
I'm willing to bet though that the debt would be larger than what the state writes in bonds. If you added up everything at the local level.
Absolutely, it would.
Absolutely.
There's a lot of overlapping debt with the state, too.
Right,
they
right,
do
right,
a lot
right.
of, they bond in a lot of projects that they shouldn't pay. So.
Right.
Anyhow, Jay, big thing here, folks. We're here to help you understand these things. You bring us out to where you are, and we'd be more than happy to enjoy the pain of looking at this. In the meantime, do what you and I did a long time ago, Jay. Look at these documents.
Mm-hmm.
See if you can make heads or tails out of it. If you can't, we're an email away. That's all you got to do.
commsolutionsmn@gmail.com. That's commsolutionsmn@gmail.com.
And another show on the way to the Community Solutions Podcast Hall of Fame.
Yes. It's easy when you're the only one making the podcast.
Right, we abduct everything.
All right. But that may not always be the case. We have big ideas. And we're going to keep those big ideas coming throughout 2020 as we march toward having 20,000 people in local government in elected and appointed seats. And we got some good things happening, but we need you. So think that over until the next podcast. And we're looking forward to hearing from you about your city's debt. We've done our part, and we love you, Minnesota. But now it's your turn to get to work.